When you see a campaign that is live, that's active, where people are being deceived, where people are being targeted, then we try to act as quickly as possible. It could be understanding the dynamics of how misinformation propagates in important health conversations, like the conversations we're having around coronavirus. It could also be understanding conspiracy theories and how they go from the fringes of the internet to becoming more mainstream. And of course, sometimes it could be understanding how some foreign nations can create fake accounts to target election and democracies. We call ourselves the cartographers of the internet. We make maps to detect attempts to manipulate online conversations. It matters to expose this type of activity, and it matters to ensure that this type of activity can be stopped before creating large-scale chaos. My name is Camille François. I am the Chief Innovation Officer at Graphika and an affiliate at the Harvard Berkman Klein Center for Internet and Society. There's a very long history of disinformation, why people manipulate one another, why nations manipulate audiences. And it's interesting because before 2016, it is not really a mainstream preoccupation. What's interesting, of course, is everybody's very focused on Russia, but there had been a lot of other countries that had been running similar operations. And so by the time we catch up, people realize that Iran had been running fake accounts targeting the US since way before Russia. China is also using these techniques to influence, for instance, what's happening during the protests in Hong Kong. And it's not just foreign governments. We, for instance, saw a PR firm based in India who was doing a disinformation campaign focused on soccer and on the World Cup to defend Qatar's reputation. When we detect new disinformation campaigns and expose them, they tend to look very different. We see a lot of diversity in these campaigns. It's an entire ecosystem with a lot of different actors who are kind of pursuing their own strategies with their own favorite tactics. We've seen AI profile pictures used in a few disinformation campaigns. It's actually getting increasingly frequent. So you use a technology which is called GAN, Generative Adversarial Networks, and basically you create a picture from someone that never existed. The other thing, of course, that is concerning is synthetic text. And so those are technologies like GPT-2, GPT-3, and it's basically able to generate articles that nobody ever wrote. But it's believable text. A lot of the campaigns that we detect is also not very technology savvy. Sometimes it's simply a bunch of freelancers that are paid to manually operate a lot of fake accounts. There are a few different pieces of technology that we employ in our everyday work. The first one is the mapping technology. And this takes a complex conversation and really just gives you a map of who are the accounts who are participating in this conversation, how are they structured between themselves, and how are they structured in relationship between one another. Sometimes we map a conversation and we see a normal set of communities engaging with one another, and in the middle, a very dense, tight set of accounts that were all created on the same day, and that is forming a tight little ball, and then we investigate and it appears to be a botnet. Now, we also have to understand what's a normal pattern and what's a suspicious pattern. It's really important when we do that we start with recognizing that normal, grassroots, spontaneous conversations can be very bizarre. You can't just take how many messages does this account send a day and just decide that if it sends too many messages, it's suspicious and it can be a troll. And so when we look at what is intense political activity, versus what is the type of activity that tries to mimic that, right? A troll farm that is trying to pretend like it's a grassroots protest, but it's really paid accounts with 4 freelancers and 300 accounts. We look at all the different ways in which the troll farm will have a hard time replicating the diversity that makes the organic conversation. The temporal diversity, the semantic diversity, and the network diversity. So these are sort of the scientific principles on which we disambiguate normal political conversation from attempts to manipulate political conversations. I'm always cautiously optimistic, and I think I have good reasons for this optimism. I really still believe that new technologies actually can make the world a better place, can help democratic societies, can help democratic uprisings around the world. I think that I was attracted to understanding what could make this dream go wrong and ensuring that I could confront the darkest corners of the internet so that we could preserve the potential of internet for democracy.